Thank you so much for coming. I'm Sun Young Shin, and this is our book launch for our book with Minnesota Historical Society Press, What We Hunger For, Refugee and Immigrant Stories about Family. And I couldn't be more excited and happy and delighted and blessed to be with three of the wonderful, wonderful contributors to this volume. So welcome. Tonight's event is co-hosted with TPT's Moving Lives Minnesota Initiative, which features stories of origin and immigration that explore the histories of the many communities who have moved through and to Minnesota. So we are coming to you from Dakota land, and I'm also coming to you from about a mile and a half south of George Floyd Square. And it's really good to be here together at this and at all times for healing, for story sharing, and for recognition. So I'm going to talk just a little bit about the inspiration and origin of the book, but I need to close my door first. One second. No, I can't. Okay, later. This book, the seed of it was really born while I was putting together A Good Time for the Truth, Race in Minnesota, which came out in April of 2016 now. And Diane Wilson's essay at the back of the book, Seeds for Seven Generations, really changed my life. It was the first piece that really touched my mind, heart, and spirit in terms of thinking about food justice in a way that really mobilized me in a way that I hadn't gotten to before. So if you have read that essay, you'll know how beautiful it is. And if you've worked with Diane Wilson or heard her speak or seen her new book, The Seed Keeper, her novel, you know that she is just like she's like a bodhisattva. She is she's on this earth to and teaching the rest of us and passing down wisdom from generations of survival and endurance, resilience, and flourishing. And so that book got me started thinking about all of the ways that food is really important to many of our communities. In Minnesota, it's been a strong contrast for me the whole time I've been here in terms of being and working with communities of color in terms of the deep sense of hospitality and in terms of the use of food as medicine, of food as a way that we connect our spirits and a way that we are connected to the land. I also appreciate the humor around food and around our encounters with food in this post-colonial time. There's so much. Yeah, so I wanted to have more conversations around our food ways and find connections. And also, you know, look at ways that we have differences and ways that we have challenges, both individual and collective. And of course, there's always been issues of what we now call cultural appropriation of food, but is really just an extension of the colonialism that, you know, built the wealth in Europe and for white people on this land. White people came here thinking it was India, looking for spices because their food was not delicious. So, you know, there's a lot to talk about, and I'm just so honored that these writers are willing to share their wisdom, their hard-earned wisdom, and all the ways that food, cooking, growing, sharing affects us. So that was really the origin of the book. I felt like a lot of times we in Minnesota are left out of the food conversations, or we're asked to have them like within each of our ethnicities or you know, cultural groups. One, many of us belong to multiple cultural groups. Two, just like with A Good Time for the Truth, you know, for people of color, we, any kind of racial challenges we have with each other, we have to solve and heal them together. We can't do that work mediated through white society because some of the wounds are because of white supremacy. And I felt that just like art, food brings us together and can help us illuminate our common humanity, as well as really the beautiful ways that we bring various threads together. So I would like to introduce you to my colleagues and role models and writers who are here with us tonight. And then each of them are going to read a page from their story and talk a little bit about it. And then I have some questions for them, or they may have questions for each other. We'll also take questions from the audience. And that's the nature of our evening. So let me introduce first Lena Jamul. She was born in Damascus, Syria, and has lived in Syria, Cyprus, London, Chicago, and Minneapolis. She is a labor and community organizer by day and theater artist and writer by night. She has a PhD in geography from Queen Mary University of London. And then next I'll read Kubi Tao's bio. He's a queer Hmong American healer based in the Twin Cities. He is founder and CEO of LIT Consulting, Lead, Inspire, Transform. Ku holds graduate degrees from St. Joseph's University and the University of Chicago, and is a 2013 Bush Fellow and a 2014 White House Champion of Change. And last but not least, one of my beloveds, Janata Petrus Nasa, is a writer, a soul sweetener, a runaway witch, and a performance artist of Black Caribbean descent, born and working on Dakota land in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Her work centers around wildness, queerness, Black diasporic futurism, ancestral healing, sweetness, shimmer, and liberation. Her first YA novel, The Stars and the Blackness Between Them, received a Coretta Scott King Honor Award. And she really, really loves to eat and write about delicious food. So please give a warm welcome. I can't see any of you, but in my mind, I can give a warm welcome to our writers. Thank you to the 60 plus people who have tuned in so far. I also want to thank the press, Minnesota Historical Society Press, my second book with them. I feel like, you know, we're married at this point. And to Shannon Pennefeather, the intrepid editor of this book, who said yes and helped the press say yes and shepherded this book from beginning to now, and has just been a tremendous partner. And to Allison Ayton, who is the publicity goddess and who helps connect all of us with all of you and helps get our books into the hands and to the eyes and ears of readers everywhere. So thank you so much to that team. If it's all right, if we would go in that same order of the bios with Lena and then Ku and then Janata, would love to. I'm really excited to hear you read a little bit and talk about your work. Thank you so much.
Wow, thank you. And Sunyoung, I just really want to thank you for inviting us to be in this project and for putting it together. It's just such an amazing gift that you play in the Twin Cities for all of us and beyond the Twin Cities too. So I will read from my piece that's called Fragments of Food Memories or Love Letter to My Dad. My father's kitchen was narrow in a small one-bedroom apartment on the sixth floor in a building in Algiers where the elevator had stopped working at least 10 years earlier, maybe more. The narrow kitchen had French doors, probably because it had been built by the colonizing French, that opened to a small narrow balcony where the laundry hung out to dry. In the corner right next to the French colonizing balcony doors was a sink, white, low, wide. At times the water would get shut off, so under the sink in the tiled floor were barrels filled with water. A plastic round container filled with water and soap was used to wash the dishes. Opposite and on the wall were hooks where my father hung the different sized pans. Next to the sink was a stove, white, small by American standards, normal by everywhere else standards. Next to the stove was a counter made of stone, heavy, durable, solid. He would lay out old newspapers to protect it. He would also lay out old newspapers to cover the low table where we ate in the living room, which functioned as a dining room and office, and at night as one of the bedrooms. The newspapers were an easy substitute for tablecloths. On the counter was where he would prep the magic. He would soak the rice in cold water. The lamb chunks, already cut by the butcher, he would sprinkle with salt. He would peel and slice the aubergines on the counter. He would salt the aubergines so they didn't drink too much oil. In his largest frying pan, where he kept oil that he would reuse I don't know how many times, he would lay the individual slices of aubergine. He would heat the second or third hand oil in the pan and submerge the aubergine slices. Deep fried aubergine slices, yum. By the way, aubergine is eggplant. Deep fried aubergine slices, yum. Put them in pita bread, khabiz, and they make amazing sandwiches. Once the aubergine slices were browned, he would carefully remove them and set them aside on a plate. He would lay out the rest of the slices in the sizzling oil. It would take about 2 to 3 rounds for him to deep fry all of his salted aubergine slices. I can never bring myself to use the same amount of oil he does, which means that I flip the aubergine over once they are browned on one side. I also lay them on paper towels to remove excess oil. Now is the time for the meat. He would fry the lamb chunks in a drop of oil until they were brown all over. Then he would add some cumin. Then he would add water and let the lamb cook. I must confess to not remembering what he would do next. He didn't enjoy having me around in his small kitchen while he cooked. There's no place to sit, and it was barely big enough for one person to be doing their thing. Cooking was a meditative process for my dad, so he liked to be alone for it. He tolerated me for a bit, and then I could tell he wanted me out of there. He enjoyed telling me how to do this and that, but I never wrote it down and remember only fragments. And so when I cook his recipes, they're part memory, part Googling similar recipes, and part adaptation. Thank you. It's interesting, like when you, Sunyan asked us to write about food, wrote about food, but immediately about my dad and a little bit about my mom. So food and family is so, food, family, place, they're just so connected. And love, it's kind of one of the ways that Arab Middle Eastern families show love, like eat. And there was a piece in the New York Times recently about Arabic food, and it was called "Do You Have Nafis?" And nafis is like spirit. Do you have the spirit to cook? So it wasn't like, it's not you're a good cook or a bad cook, it's do you have the spirit to cook? And my dad really had the spirit to cook, and I had the spirit to eat. I'll just leave it there unless you want me to say a little more.
That's beautiful. for now. I'm in love with it already. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Cool.
Yes. Hi, everyone. This is Ku. Pronouns are he, him. I just want to echo, thank you so much, Sanyang, for creating this opportunity. So my chapter is called Manjikle. And as I was preparing for this, I realized that I didn't put anything in the chapter that says, like, this is how you pronounce this. But I'm also glad that I didn't, because I wanted it to just be what it is. But I do have my manjikle here, which is rice mixed with cold water. It's nothing fancy, but it, as you will hear in my reading, you'll understand what the heck this is. So I'm just gonna read two short pieces that kind of flow together to explain my chapter. So this is manjikle. Every Hmong child grew up eating manjikle, rice mixed with water, whether they were raised in Chiang Mai, Thailand, or Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Even I, the first Hmong person ever born in New Jersey, knew the joys of being handed a bowl of warm rice doused in cold water. Manjikle is steamed short grain rice mixed with water to make it easier for children to eat. Sometimes the rice is freshly cooked, and other times it's left over from the day before. This quintessential dish may seem oddly bland unless you're Hmong. Even as an adult, when I think about manjikle, my mouth starts to water and my throat yearns to be quenched. My mind drifts back to rare weekends when my mom didn't have time to cook and my dad was in charge of dinner. Most often, dinners with dad were beef jerky and manjikle. At the time, my younger sister Melinda and I always complained and asked if we could order pizza instead. However, looking back, there was something refreshing and comforting about slurping the cold water out of the rice bowl after a salty bite of jerky. My dad would scold us, saying we were lucky to be eating meat at all. He'd tell stories of growing up poor in the villages of Laos and how all they had to eat was rice mixed with water and hot pepper. The chunks of beef accompanying our rice bowls were luxuries. Stories of food were often accompanied by tales of how he had to walk through the jungle for 5 days past tigers to reach his elementary school. This lesson was thrust upon us whenever we didn't want to wake up for the school bus. "You're lucky you have a bus," he'd yell at us. Then I'm gonna just jump to another quick section. Food is how Hmong parents show love. Most of us go a lifetime without our parents or elders ever telling us they love us verbally. But every single day, whether we're upset or have just gotten into a fight, they will still ask us, "Kapatan na ma, did you eat yet?" Even after criticizing how much weight we've gained, they will force us to eat more. Recently, my mom turned to me in the kitchen and said, "You are so handsome." I stood still as a deer, ears perked, waiting for what I knew was sure to be a punchline. She continued, "If you just lose 20 pounds, you will be even more handsome." There was the arrow to the heart. She then ordered me to eat the sugar-coated donuts she had just pulled out of the fryer. This is how Hmong people show love: radical hospitality through food, through hosting, and through building community. So just a little bit about this piece. It's a little bit of everything, you know? When I think about food, I love to eat. And when I was a kid, I really loved to eat. And so, you know, the book starts with my childhood and my struggles with obesity as a child. And then it traces my journey through identity, through food, or my lack of identity, of understanding who Hmong people are, because I grew up in New Jersey on the East Coast. And then it follows the journey of not only my journey, but the Hmong journey of the role food has played in our lives. And really, you know, in many ways, I think of this chapter as a love letter to my Hmong people. And part of why I'm glad I didn't put a pronunciation guide in there is because this is for my Hmong people who, you know, are so intricately tied to food, the land, and cultivating that. And that has been lost over many years because of generations of war and persecution. And so, you know, I feel so honored to be included in this chapter with these incredible authors, all from these different perspectives. And there is this commonality, even in just the couple of stories that I've read so far, this commonality and this theme across, no matter where you come from, that there's these ties that bind us around food and healing and also trauma. But really, you know, part of what I'm trying to share in my chapter is a call to say, how can we reclaim or re-envision the role of food in our lives so that it's intently healing rather than trying to mask the wounds that we've sometimes forgotten were there. So that's a short kind of recap of what my chapter is about.
Well, y'all are so amazing. Thank you, Sunyoung, for like bringing Lena and Ku and their brilliant, like soulful writing to my attention, as well as all of the other brilliant people who some I know and are homies and some are new. And I feel like just deep gratitude to Sunyoung for, yeah, just including me in this invitation to think about my family and food and how so much of how I understand my culture has to do with food. Okay. I'll just read a little bit from my piece called Lake Superior Looks Like the Ocean to Island Girls from Minnesota. 8. Food is the way I know a lot of what it is to be Trinidadian and Cajun as a Black girl in Minnesota. I think that is how a lot of immigrant kids learn home, the home that exists in our blood, but not in our experience. We don't know the lands and crops and waters of our ancestry, but it is archived in the foods that keep us alive. Both of my parents were born on islands in the Caribbean that were worlds away from the landlocked Midwest they migrated to and where I was born. I was born on Dakota land, Phillips neighborhood, South Minneapolis, and saw my mom make community with our neighbors and friends in the language of food. One of her best friends, Miss Linda, was another single mother like my mom. She was from Illinois. She would trade plates of Southern Black cooking for my mama's Caribbean curries. There was a Vietnamese family across the street with whom we would do a similar food tasting exchange. The father, whose name was Sun, would make skewered pork on kebab sticks and would marinate it in some kind of lemongrass, otherworldly seasoned goodness. So good. I can still remember when the smell would come from across the street and eventually the transformative taste. There was a native brother who liked my mama and would make bratwurst and bring chips and Shasta for all us kids to eat, as well as wild rice from his reservation for my mama to make chicken wild rice soup, which she would share back with him. 9. My mom went to cooking school when I was 4 years old. She would take the bus to drop me and my younger sister, Anika, to daycare. Then she would take the bus to downtown Minneapolis to attend school. In the wintertime, we would be woken up in darkness, faces wiped and clothes and snow suits put on. Our father felt some type of way about her going back to school and wasn't willing to help her with us, my mother told me when I was older. The main thing I remember from that time is loving her homework because it was always delicious and alchemical. Anika and I would watch her make and decorate cakes and cookies. She would make foods from all over the world, and we would be her taste testers and sample things like borscht, hummus, and gingerbread. My mother, like many other immigrant and low-income food geniuses, worked for minimum wage in kitchens that didn't deserve her. In those places, she befriended people from all over the world and bonded over their traditional foods from home. When she worked at the Hyatt Hotel on slow days, the head chef would allow one of the kitchen staff to make stuff from their home countries. She learned mole from her Ecuadorian homie and how to work with Ethiopian herbs through friends she met in the basement kitchens of these whack-ass jobs. That's enough for me to read. Similar to what you were saying, cool, like there's a lot in reading y'all's pieces that it's just so beautiful to relate to, especially because we come from such very different places in the world. Just like how so much of, I think, like even for our families, like, you know, the ways that they could even sort of like try to resemble a connection to home is through the food they make. So, yay. Thank y'all.
Thank you so much. I am crying on the inside, but I will save it. I'm going to save all my salty tears for later. Thank you so much, everyone in the chat. Please put questions and comments for our three authors. They are ready to answer your questions like ninjas. I'm just staring in there. I also wanted to read the list of the all of the contributors to the book because we will be having more events, and I hope that everyone in the book will be willing to be in, you know, events for years to come, because the nature of our food conversations and the relationships we have around them are not going to expire. I think this book is both timely and timeless. That's my little blurb right at the moment. But the whole list of geniuses is Valerie Deus, Vivi Ganeshanathan, Roy G. Guzman. Side note, Roy's first book of poetry has its anniversary tomorrow, and we will be reading poetry and doing finger painting tomorrow. So catch us then. Lena Jamul, Simi Kong, Mei Li Yang, Anhua T. Nguyen, Zarlasht Niaz, Ku B. Tao, Michael Torres, Seimukta Duong Fukse Vongse, and Sena Yeboah Sampong. Amazing. Thank you. And thank you, Allison, for putting all the names in the chat. So the question, what is your earliest food memory for Ku, Lena, and Janata? That is great. Thank you, Jennifer.
That's a good question. Are one of y'all willing to answer? Y'all go ahead.
I'll start. This is totally random, but it's totally aligned with me being Hmong American and born in the US. I thought of two things. I guess the first is rice and water, and the second is McDonald's.
Yeah, go ahead. Were you gonna say something? Go for it.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember. I think it's chicken. So part of one of the things that is in my book here is that my mom did not like to cook. My dad loved to cook and my mom didn't. You know, she was a single mom for most of the time that she raised me. And there was, she would get this in Damascus, a rotisserie chicken that's kind of just ready. And so she would get that. And I was, And they would say that I would eat like half a chicken as a baby, so like really fat baby.
Amazing, I love it. Yeah. Did a memory come to you?
Yeah. No, it's funny because cool, when you brought up McDonald's, I was like, Janata, don't be basic and really feel like part of. And I think it has specifically something to do with being an immigrant kid, because it's such a like. you know, propaganda around Americanness. So I feel like part of my food memories really come from the juxtaposition between my Americanness via food and what was sort of out there. But something that came to mind is just like a story. I remember like my grandma's sister came up from Trinidad and she was like supposed to cook us food. And I remember we were like, yeah, we like spaghetti. We want spaghetti, like typical American kids, right? So then she made stewed chicken, which is this certain kind of chicken from Trinidad, and noodles. So basically she made stewed chicken and noodles, which like to us was like probably bomb as hell now. I would eat the hell out of that shit. But as a kid, it was like, where's the spaghetti? You know, so just sort of like how I think Caribbean people interpret, or just like whatever, like, you know, people coming and trying to interpret Americanness and how sometimes, like, yeah, like the foods I love now so much were foods that like, as a kid, I was like weird about, you know? So like when you brought up aubergine, eggplant, similarly, in your piece.
Yeah. Oh my gosh, these questions are so good now. Okay, that's too many good questions. That's amazing. I want just to add on to Koo's, because one of my, it's not my first earliest memory, but, and I talk a little bit about this in the introduction, and that, you know, I'm adopted, and anyone who knows me knows that, but in terms of food, when I came to the United States, I was about 1.5 and I was speaking Korean and I'd been eating Korean foods. But one of the things in my like medical records, adoption records from when I was in foster care was that, you know, what babies had then was rice milk. There wasn't formula. There wasn't, you know, boutique purchasable breast milk from other women. There wasn't even, people weren't, they weren't even feeding, yeah, feeding infants or toddlers cow's milk or goat's milk or anything like that. So rice milk was what I had for this like 6 or 9 months before I came to the United States. And then I was asking for milk. It's uyu in Korean. So that's something that has always, that's one of my food stories that I don't remember, but that is really a part of my transition and my migration story that, you know, is part of my loss. That's really part of my loss and trauma, because I was with my mother, my Korean mother, and breastfeeding. And then I went to foster care and I was trying to, you know, nurse on my foster mother, and that wasn't happening, you know. So, and then in the, a lot of the adoptees from my era in the 70s with the rice milk, like it's not good for your teeth, you know, your baby teeth. And so that's just like another kind of medical thing that ties us together, some of us. And yeah, just tracing all these things is for so many of us kind of like hidden, yeah, hidden histories, hidden legacies. So thank you for bringing the water and rice. Yeah. This is a lovely question about implements. There's too many good questions, but do any of you have a special cooking utensil that you learned to use from your family that you cherish? That's a good question.
I don't, but one thing I want to get is a roti pan. I don't know if people are familiar with Trinidadian food. There's a food called roti, which is basically a lot of different curried vegetables that are eaten in this kind of like roti skin. It's like this flat, fluffy, delicious hot bread. And it's made on this flat pan that you put on your stove. That I don't own one, like my mom owns it. And I think that's kind of a lot of the stuff I'm realizing is that like there's some stuff that like I turned 40 this year. I'm like, I got to learn how to make some of these dishes. I got to, you know, get some of these utensils. So, yeah. How about y'all?
Nina, do you
want
to?
I don't have a special cooking utensil. But similarly, I've been thinking of getting, you know, in the In the chapter, I write about maqlube, maqluba, which is means upside down, and it's a dish that you turn upside down. And I just bought this pan recently, and they were like advertising more, buy more to me. And there was like this like totally mainstream American company was selling things that you can use to then turn upside down. And it said like, oh, and many Middle Eastern dishes use it. And so I was like, oh, it's kind of like this, a little bit like Sun Yang's introduction of the narrative plentitude of, and then like, it's just so rare that we see ourselves. And so, yeah, that's.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think I'm thinking about a walk, like a really good walk, but I mean, I don't even have a really good walk, but I have a decent walk, which is really helpful. And then also my mom, she was living with me for a couple of years, and then she gave me her best nonstick pans. Because mine are horrible, and you need like at least three different really good nonstick pans because for many dishes. But one of our dishes, it's like a rice flour rolls. We call it fogao. You need to get the batter, and then you get a really hot skillet, and then you pour it, and it creates like kind of a tortilla type right thing, and you put the meat inside, and whenever I would cook with her, she would have three skillets going and be like pouring and then like cooking and then like flipping. And I'm trying to do like one. And she was like, just get out of the way.
Right.
Let me do my magic. So then when she left, she moved away and she gave me one of her pans.
Oh, that was a good inheritance. Yeah. A lovely question from the patron goddess of this book, Diane Wilson. Can you all speak to how your families gathered their food? Did they garden, forage, hunt, shop at markets? Were those skills passed on?
Yeah. Hi, Diane. Diane is also was super critical to my book, actually. Was a mentor. So I loved hearing that she was also like a seed in this piece. But to answer the question, yeah. So in the piece, I write about how my mother's grandfather, who she was raised with, gardened, and how a lot of my mom's sort of early entry into cooking was through gardening and cooking with her grandfather in Trinidad in like the 50s and 60s. And with a note of that, you know, with a lot of sort of folks who, you know, came from the Caribbean in the 50s and 60s and earlier too, you know, went to England, went to New York, went to Toronto, and a lot of the children, you know, would stay on with whoever was there. So my mother's grandfather, yeah, like there's a lot of things that now where we get food, typically, if, you know, we don't grow as much, there's stuff, you know, we certainly do grow, but usually it was between like Asian groceries and Mexican groceries is where we got stuff for the Caribbean, you know, food that we ate. So I feel like, and then there's like one Caribbean grocery store, like somewhere in Bloomington. Like, I feel like there's, so as far as foraging, like, I feel like that's how we've been able to be like, okay, cool. Here they have these ingredients, right? Here they have these ingredients. And some of the, you know, overlap, you know, in different places throughout the world, as far as what Trinidadian cuisine is, which is like, is a very global, you know, food tradition, actually. Yeah. South Asian, East Asian, African, European, indigenous, you know, so a lot of that comes through in the food.
Yeah, you know, I talk about pieces of this in the chapter, but growing up, my parents both worked all the time. And so they didn't have time to garden, but they love gardening. And, you know, now that they're retired, all they do is farm, and all their vegetables are fresh. So they moved to South Carolina and they have, I kid you not, 130 chickens and 60 quails and their garden, right? So like they love fresh gardening, fresh herbs, fresh animals. My mom's also an herbalist. And I talk about this in the book, chapter two, how she has all this amazing knowledge and my grandma as well. But it's lost, right? Like, well, it has not been passed down. And partly like, I didn't ask, right? At least about like herbology and like, you know, she has an herb or like a tree bark for any ailment that you have. And I have CVS, right? Like something was lost there, you know, and it is on me too to not ask, but it's also like, I have no idea how I would ever get that download of knowledge. And, you know, in my book, I talk about how like a large part of my health, you know, health as a child and obesity was tied to, we were eating American food, processed foods, fast food to show that we had assimilated. And we grew up on the East Coast with no Hmong people. So like there was no Hmong market, you know, any of that stuff. We really ate like a lot of American food, except for, you know, rare occasions. But well, I mean, it was a mix, but it wasn't until we got much older and my parents retired that they were able to grow their own food again.
There's a piece in the book that I write about my grandmother's chickens that that she had in the yard, my dad's mom. And that was, so they, and those eggs were amazing, incredible eggs. I still kind of remember what they taste like. So there was some of that. And then when we moved to Cyprus, I mean, Cyprus is very close to Syria, similar climate. So you can get some of the foods there, but not all of it. And I remember, actually, I just remembered this now that you all were talking, that my mom was obsessed with coffee and she would want Arabic coffee and couldn't get it anywhere in Cyprus at the time. And so she, like, whoever was coming from Syria or another, would like bring this coffee for my mom, like big batches of coffee. And sometimes some other stuff like melochia you couldn't get in Cyprus. And so, which is like dried mallows leaf. It doesn't have to be dried, it could be fresh too. So families like visiting each other would bring each other these like bulk food items so you could, that you couldn't get.
That's amazing. Thank you. I guarantee that if you buy this book that you'll read each essay and think, I want a whole book from this person about this. I mean, it's just like a little slice. It's like kaleidoscopic. It's really just, I'm in love. I'm not biased, but I'm in love. So there's all these other good questions. I'm going to read them and then, Janata, Lena, Ku, whatever you want to answer. This is like the, bonus round. Okay. So this question about kind of Lena, you just answered one of them, is having access to your indigenous foods ever a challenge and growing? So actually you all kind of answered that. Shannon's first question, what do you feel the relationship is between immigrant foods in the US and dominant discourses of immigration in the US? And then her second question, is it important that this book is coming out of Minnesota, a place known for its immigrant and refugee communities, but a place that's not widely recognized yet for its world cuisines compared to NYC, LA, or DC, for example. And then there was another, let's see. Yeah, so Chris, Mary Austin Speakers asks, is there a dish from your culture you wish you could make? Any of those questions. Immigration discourse and food.
Kai Ying, I'm not sure if I'm saying it right, also has a great question. Do y'all enjoy cooking? Your writing is delicious. Thank you, friend.
That's a good one too. Yeah.
I One of the dishes that I wrote about is mluchie. Mallows leaves. I think that's what it's called. I don't know what it's called in English. But I'd always like want to eat it all the time. And you know, if I go back home and they'll ask me, you know, what do you want to eat? Is one of the questions they'll ask, like what. What should we cook for you? And then after I wrote this, I actually tried to cook it, and I did, and it was just like, oh, I can make. I'm like a grown up. I'm like 40 years plus old. Like, oh, I can make this stuff. It was like kind of a revelation. And yeah, that's all that sparked. And so yeah, that's. Connected to the do you like to cook? Yes, I do love to cook all kinds of things, and when I cook Arabic food, it feels extra special.
One question that I think is interesting, I mean actually all the questions are great, but I wanted to talk to I want to answer the enjoy cooking question and then this book being written out of Minnesota question. So I do love cooking. I love cooking. It's one of my love languages. I think it's a thing that I'm very much, like as I get older, I realize like I've gotten really good. I became a vegetarian when I was 13, you know? And my mom actually in the 70s and before I was born, you know, kicked it with a lot of Rastafarians, which they eat a very vegan plant-based diet. So a lot of how we grew up eating was very, you know, from the land and whatnot. But there's some foods like curry chicken I don't know how to make. That I'd love to learn how to make. Like, I really am interested in making more traditional foods and learning how to make those. But yeah, I love to cook. And I think I can cook. I think I got the spirit. When you said the thing about the spirit, because I do think, like, there is this idea about, like, do you know how to cook? And some people love to cook but can't cook. And there's people who can cook, you know what I mean? But maybe, you know, they don't do it all the time. But, like, they got the spirit, you know? And I just loved... sort of, it just felt like, yeah, like it just felt very gracious, you know, to just sort of understand like, yeah, it's the spirit that can find you too, maybe. But as far as, and I would love to hear what y'all think too about this question around Minnesota, especially given, you know, everybody's work. Like, I do think that, yeah, I do think like in Minnesota, there's a lot of attention to like, you know, white male chefs, specifically when they do cuisines that are, you know, other cultural cuisines. And I feel like some of my favorite foods and restaurants are from like, you know, yeah, those spaces that aren't considered like fancy cuisine, but like are the best ass food, you know? And I think that like plays in a role with a lot of the things we're seeing around how Minnesota is like the best place to live if you're white, you know? And it's a very different reality if you're not. And I think like the visibility of whiteness and white, you know, sort of doing good things, you know what I mean? And being awarded for it. Like, I think the ways that other communities are excluded from cuisine and they're being celebrated for like their mastery of culinary stuff. And this is me, like, you know, I mentioned in my piece, like some of the best chefs in the world work in kitchens for white people, you know? And, you know, there's, you know, obviously, like, I think locally, there's like some tremendous, you know, cooking happening, but like all of these fancy awards, these white stuff on spaces, you know? So I do think like sort of speaking around, you know, A, like, I don't think people think about immigrant communities here. And cool, I had the opposite experience of you in that I was born in the Midwest, away from the East Coast where there's a ton of Caribbean people, you know? So like a lot of, you know, yeah, I think like for me, like there's a lot of interesting ways that there's an immigrant population here that's very nuanced. It's different than what's on the East Coast. It's different than what's on the West Coast. And I'm excited for this book to actually convey that through food and this beautiful writing.
I think I'll speak to a couple questions as well. So Kaying, your question about do we like to cook? So hi Kaying. I love cooking. And I really, you know, it was in writing the chapter that I really realized how much of an influence my mom had on my cooking. And just like my search for like all types of foods from all cultures, like I've always had that all my life, and it really is from my mom. And so there's like a whole section where I just talk about my mom cooking. Like she was making like banchillo from Vietnamese culture. She was making empanadas from her like her Ecuadorian friend. Like, you know, and so Janata, it reminded me of what you were saying, right, with your mom. Because my mom was working in factories with all these women, mothers from around the world, and they were just going to each other's houses, like, and cooking, you know. So I really got that from my mom. And I think the question, you know, about, like, immigration and all that, it's, you know, it's really just making me thinking about what's happening now to Asian Americans in this country. And so, you know, like, people feel like they can hate Asian Americans and blame COVID on us and yet go eat our food, right? And there's so much that you could unpack there. For every culture, right? Like racists loving our food, but hating us, right? Mm-hmm. Hating us being in America. And it is interesting in the Twin Cities, because you have Hmong village and you have like a lot of mom and pop shops owned by Hmong vendors. And sometimes, you know, many of them are catering to different audiences. So they may be, they may have a Chinese restaurant or they may have a Thai restaurant, right? Because not a lot of people know what Hmong food is, but it's changing rapidly. I think especially, you know, think about like Chef Ye Vang, who, you know, is really changing the scene here. And shout out, because we grew up in Pennsylvania together. you know, all Hmong people know each other. So, you know, I'll stop there.
I love that. Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Other thoughts the three of you want to share or respond to?
I love, not love, but I so feel that sentiment around like, just like how, and maybe this plays into some of the stuff you were saying earlier, Sun Young, around like colonialism, imperialism, and just how so much of it is around like consuming what we are and what our soul is without wanting to acknowledge the sacredness of who we are. And yeah, and I do feel like, yeah, to me, it's interesting just some of these things. Like when you were talking, cool, I was like, and I wrote this in the chat. We have a chat that y'all can't see. We want to chat with y'all, but they won't let us chat. I don't know how all these things want to be special. But anyway, but I was like, yo, immigrant mamas be the hugest foodies. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like I would love a show where it's just like immigrant mamas, like going around eating food and talking fucking shit. And like enjoying it. Like I feel like my mom, like she's this, yeah, anyways, I'm just like feeling that vibe.
I would watch that.
I would watch that.
That would be amazing.
Yeah, that would be real. Oh my gosh. Chris Martin had a good question, or interesting question, I think, that I don't have time to answer, but I will say that, you know, I feel like in terms of how do I think about this book, I have a lot of different ways I think about it. But in general, I feel like I'm kind of like a, I don't know, not like a reporter, not like approaching like a generalist, I think partially from being a high school teacher for 13 years. And like, you just have to know a little bit about a lot of things. You don't necessarily have time to get too deep into any one thing. And then like with the parallel of my own journey as an adoptee and immigrant, and as a mother of two and a migrant to Minnesota, I'm an expat to Minnesota. And then growing up, I think I talk about it in the introduction a little bit, but growing up in like a Polish, Irish, German, American family in Chicago that was really had a lot of, maintained a lot of traditions from the old world, and that my mother's mother spoke Polish and made Polish food. And my dad has a lot of like German sayings or had, he's passed, but that food in Chicago is really particular. There's a lot of different old world foods. The restaurant industry is very racialized in a particular way. Like I grew up with Greek restaurant owners, white women named Flo in their 60s being waitresses. And then there's Latino, Latinx busboys and cooks, right? And like my growing racially in Chicago and the Chicago area was so racialized, but also within the white spectrum, there's so many different kinds of whites, you know? And then, so much of the work that I've done since I moved to Minnesota is about like why Minnesota whiteness felt really different than where I came from, or from, you know, I spent a year in Boston and that felt really different too, but I was like used to a lot of Irish people. So in some ways it wasn't all that different. So anyway, we love to leave you wanting more. We're gonna have so many more events. Please come, please buy this book for Mother's Day or Person's Day, or just you know, help support the press so that the press can continue to support books like this and authors of color and Indigenous authors, because I hate to remind us, but you know, one of the heartbreaking things about putting this book together was that I was asking all of these beautiful people, all of these writers of color, to finish these essays and turn them in like right in the wake of George Floyd's murder. I mean, and it was in the months after that I was torn, like, do I ask a person of color for anything right now and in the pandemic? But also, you know, my desire to have this book at this time was also winning out. I mean, I don't know, because work goes on, and this was also a really joyful project, and I hope it continues to be joyful and provocative for the readers it finds, and hopefully students as well. So please get in touch with us if you are looking to book us, or you want to teach this book. Like, we're just,
or you want to feed us?
Yes, we are excited to eat
on food
with you all when it's safe to do so, and it seems like we're emerging. So please come to the next event if you can, or spread the word on May 20th. And Allison has put that link in there, or follow me on Facebook, follow the press. And thank you for spending an hour of your evening with us. Thank you so much to Janata, Lena, Ku, and everyone else who's been a part of this book. And this is just like the first event of the journey, and I'm just so grateful. So thank you so much, and we'll see you soon.